20, the 1989 Milwaukee Brewers. Turning 20, the story of the 1989 Milwaukee Brewers is presented by America's favorite light beer, Miller Lite. When it's Miller Lite, less filling tastes great.
You know, baseball cards are real popular these days. For one Ron say, I can get a whole case of my favorite beer, Miller Lite. I don't want some watered-down minor league version of a regular beer. I want the less filling beer that tastes great.
Hey, Ace! Give me two cases, you can have this baby.
Dream on.
One case.
Nope.
A six-pack.
Mm-mm.
A half a can?
The Big League Light Beer, Miller Lite, where less filling tastes great.
Okay, I'll give you two cases, and you don't have to take the cart. But that's my final offer.
Must have a couple of mine already.
Whoa.
The 1989 Milwaukee Brewers had hoped their mix of up-and-coming young players and seasoned veterans would be the right formula for the club's first American League East title since 1982. But five starters from the 1988 team, Paul Molitor, Greg Brock, Dale Swaim, Teddy Higuera, and then Juan Nieves began the season on the disabled list. And again, injuries would plague the club throughout the year. But early on, the Brewers kept pace. The quick return of Molitor to the lineup, April 14th, gave the team an immediate boost.
Get up, get out of here, gone for Paulie. Welcome back, Paul Molitor.
And Brock's three-run blast signaled his return to the lineup on May the 31st. Through June, the Brew crew stayed on the heels of first-place Baltimore, and with a 7-2 defeat of the Orioles on July 9th, the Brewers were only seven games back. As the month of July drew to a close, a 6-4 win over Cleveland left the crew only four games back of the slumping Orioles. Robin Yount keyed the offense in the month, hitting .395 with 11 doubles and 24 RBIs, earning him the American League's Player of the Month award. In July, Yount had a career-high 19-game hitting streak, batting .446 with a pair of home runs.
Get up and get out of here. Gone for Robin.
By mid-August, the Brewers were back in the pennant race. A three-run ninth inning off Yankee reliever Dave Righetti on August 14th gave Brewer fans reason to get excited.
There it is, hit fair, down the left field line. This is gonna do it. Hey, BJ scores on a base hit by Polidor, and this Brewer ball club is going crazy. How about that?
The season-ending injury to Jim Gattner on August 15th dealt a major blow to the Brewers. But on August 18th, a 5-2 win over Boston would put the Brewers only one half game back, with a crucial road trip against Baltimore and Toronto coming up. But the Brewers ran into a red-hot Baltimore Oriole ball club at Memorial Stadium in Baltimore and were swept in three. Then they lost 3-4 to the Toronto Blue Jays, and after winning only two games of a six-game homestand, the Brewers found themselves back in fourth place with 22 games remaining. Despite an outstanding West Coast trip, which included a six-game winning streak, the Brewers could not gain ground. The streak began with a 7-4 victory over the Angels September the 6th. Then Mark Knutson knocked off Seattle on September the 10th by a score of 7-1, but the Brewers were still 7 1/2 games behind. The Brewers won two from the Blue Jays on the final homestand of the season, but the schedule ran out before the team could reach the top. The Brewers ended the season in fourth place at 81-81.
1989 was a season in which we played very, very hard. We frustrated ourselves because of inconsistencies, but the ball club on a day-to-day basis really gave me a good effort and gave the fans a good effort, and I think really held up well under some really adverse situations, and mainly the injuries, but also the inconsistency. Very frustrating, very stressful, but the ball club came to the ballpark every day expecting to win, and with the exception of three really little flat times where we didn't score runs, we had a pretty solid season.
The 89 season may have been disappointing, but the Brewers provided excitement with some great plays.
Well,
Milwaukee Brewer fans have grown accustomed to the solid yearly performances of Paul Molitor, Robin Yount, and Jim Gattner. The injury to Jim Gattner in August cut short a personal best season. He was on his way to establishing a career mark in stolen bases and hitting .274 when he was lost for the year.
The atmosphere he brings into the clubhouse each day, the respect that he commands from each teammate and coaches and management, he is just the one guy on this club that is as well liked as anybody possibly could ever be. And his competitive spirit and the excitement he brings out there on the field to our teammates today, we just could not replace that when Jimmy went down.
Gantner's .274 average and 20 stolen bases were third best on the club. Paul Molitor's healthy season was a major plus for the team. Playing in 155 games for only the second time in his career, Molitor batted .315, giving him his third straight 300-plus season. His 27 stolen bases topped the club, and his 194 hits and 35 doubles were the second best of his career. On September the 8th in Seattle, Paulie's three doubles tied a club record. Molitor went on a hitting tear in September, putting together a 19-game streak in which he went 41 for 77, a staggering .532 average. He was named the American League's September Player of the Month. From September 1st to the end of the season, Molly hit an amazing .458.
His whole season was really solid. Once he came off the disabled list in April, he didn't miss any games. He played through injuries, he played around injuries, and he gave us a typical Paul Molitor year. On-base percentage excellent, stolen base percentage excellent, run scored excellent. He just had another Paul Molitor year, and one of the keys, of course, to our success and the fact that we did hang in that pennant race was the resurgence of Paulie at the end and also the steadiness of Paulie throughout the entire season and leadership role in this ball club.
With each game that he steps on the field, Robin Yount continues to establish records and milestones. This season, Rockin' Robin tied Gorman Thomas for most career home runs by a Brewer with 208, while establishing a new club record for consecutive games played at 276. When discussion of the American League's most valuable player began late in the season, Yount's name was frequently mentioned. He led the Brewers in batting at .318, putting him fourth in the American League. Consider these additional stats. 101 runs scored, 38 doubles, 21 home runs, and his third 100-plus RBI season with 103. He also hit .328 on the road, second best in the American League. On July the 2nd, in a 10-2 win over the Yankees, Yount reached another milestone, base hit number 2,500. In becoming the 63rd player in Major League history to reach that plateau, Yount became the fifth youngest, being surpassed only by Hall of Famers Ty Cobb, Rogers Hornsby, Mel Ott, and Hank Aaron. In tribute to his achievement, the Brewers designated July 7th Robin Yount Day at Milwaukee's County Stadium. Robin responded with a first-inning home run. The special day was a fitting honor to a player whose 16-year career in Milwaukee has been special.
Fires 1-2 to Yount. Robin lines one to center, a base hit. Molitor scores, Leonard stops at third. The throw comes in, 1,000 ribbies for Robin. And now a standing ovation for Robin Yount at County Stadium. On the right field line. A long run for Snyder. Base hit. Robin with career base hit number 2,000. Here's the pitch. Robin sends a bouncer over the head of Paliarulo in the left to base hit. There's 2,500 for Robin. Two runs score and the Brewers lead 7-0. That's number 2,500 for Robin Yount.
Reliever Dan Plesac, Milwaukee's representative at the 1989 All-Star Game and the only Brewer to be selected three consecutive times, established a pair of club records this season. The Sackman's 33 saves broke the mark of 31, held by a former outstanding Brewer reliever, Ken Sanders. He also jumped into first place among Brewer relievers with 100 career saves, topping the previous mark held by Raleigh Fingers. One constant of any Tom Treblehorn team is base running. 1989 was no exception. For the third straight season, the Brewers led the American League in stolen bases, the first AL East team to capture that title 3 years in a row. Once again, the Igniter led the way. Paul Molitor's 27 steals topped the club. Jim Gantner contributed 20 more to the team league-high total of 165, even though his season was ended in mid-August. And Mike Felder sped his way to 26 stolen bases. Felder was among the Brewers who saw increased action in 1989. He played in a career-high 117 games and responded with 50 runs scored, 11 doubles, 3 home runs, all career bests. This home run off Nolan Ryan was a highlight of the season for Charlie O'Brien. The catcher contributed 6 home runs, 35 RBIs, and several clutch hits to the Brewer attack in only 62 games. To round out the Brewer offense in 1989, Greg Brock batted 265, his best career mark. That's a 53-point increase over his 88 average. Glenn Bragg set career highs in home runs, runs scored, and stolen bases. B.J. Surhoff hit his first career grand slam and had a career high in triples. He also drove in 55 runs. Rob Deere connected for 26 round trippers, giving him his fourth 20-plus home run season with the Brewers. 19 pitchers saw action for the Brewers in 1989, including 13 in a starting role. Although 8 pitchers spent all or part of the season on the disabled list, the Brewers staff put together a respectable ERA of 3.80, sixth best in the American League. The pitching staff in 1990 promises to be the deepest in years. One of the bright spots on the staff was Chris Bosio. The 4-year veteran was tagged with the workhorse role as a starter and responded with his best season in the big leagues. Bosio was 15-10 with an earned run average of 2.95. He ranked among the league leaders in complete games and strikeouts.
He gave us quality starts day in and day out. The innings he pitched were instrumental in setting up our entire pitching staff. Without a pitcher who is reliable, without a pitcher who can go into your 7th and 8th innings every time out there, you're always having problems with running the relievers out there too often. And Chris was that one guy who allowed us to go deep into ball games, allowed us to set our bullpen up for games both before and after him. And that's always important for success of any pitching staff, to have that guy who is reliable. And Chris was certainly reliable.
Although back surgery, ankle, and shoulder problems limited Brewer ace Teddy Higuera to only 22 starts in 89, the always consistent left-hander finished with a 9-6 record and a 3.46 ERA. Don August ended the season on a strong note and finished second on the staff with 12 wins in 25 starts, despite a brief stint in Denver late in the season. A pleasant surprise for the starting staff was rookie Jamie Navarro. Navarro was pressed into service on June 20th and gave up only one earned run in 6 2/3 innings in his major league debut. He finished the season with 7 wins and a 3.12 ERA. Among other pitchers who took to the hill as starters, Brian Clutterbuck pitched well early in the year before shoulder surgery ended his season. Tom Filer was called up from Denver and finished the season with a 7-3 record in 13 starts. Mark Knutson and Bill Krueger proved to be valuable members of the staff as they gave manager Tom Treblehorn flexibility as starters or relievers. Knutson had a 3.35 ERA and put together a 6-1 mark in 7 spot starts. Krueger had 3 wins and 3 saves in 34 appearances. The middle relief corps was called upon for a bigger role in 1989. The mainstays were Chuck Krim and Tony Fossas. Krim led the American League in appearances for the second straight year with 76. He picked up 9 wins in relief and 7 saves while compiling a 2.83 ERA. His success as a setup man was essential to the 89 Brewers. Fossas took over the lefty setup role. The mechanic had 2 wins and 1 save and allowed only 3 home runs in 61 innings of work. He finished third on the club with 51 appearances.
I think if we don't have a Mark Knutson, if we don't have a Tommy Filer, if we don't have a Tony Fossas, if we don't have a Billy Krueger, and if we don't have a Chuck Krim, we'd have had all kinds of problems in the pitching. And those guys kept us close, kept us in ball games, came out of the bullpen to start, came in early, came in the middle, set things up, and also saved ball games for us. So they played a very important role in giving us a contending pitching staff. The pitching staff in 1989 pitched well enough for us to win the Eastern Division.
When the Brewer pitching staff needed defensive support, the Brewer fielders were there to lend a helping hand. The Milwaukee Brewers celebrated their 20th anniversary in 1989, and while the club has had many fond memories from the past two decades, the American League pennant and the World Series appearance in 1982 rank as highlights. As part of the anniversary celebration, the Brewers and Miller Lite sponsored fan balloting for the 20th anniversary team. Some of the players most remembered by the Brewer faithful were those from that championship season of 1982. Making up the infield were Cecil Cooper, Jimmy Gattner, Rockin' Robin Yount, and the igniter Paul Molitor. The outfield consisted of Sixto Lascano, Ben Ogilvie, and then Gorman Thomas. The fans selected Charlie Moore as the catcher. Henry Aaron was selected the designated hitter. Left-handed starter Mike Caldwell. And right-handed starter Pete Vukovich. And the relief ace, Raleigh Fingers, rounded out the squad. From a look at the past to a look into the future, the Brewers get ready for the 1990s with some young players whose futures look bright. On April 17th, rookie shortstop Billy Spiers made his mark on the majors in a big way.
Get up and get out of here. Gone! A grand salami for Billy Spiers. His first home run in the major leagues, a grand slammer, and the Brewers now lead this game. Ho-ho! Wow, how about that?
Due to a lack of playing time, Spiers was sent back to Denver in late June. He returned to Milwaukee with a bang, hitting .341 in July.
He's a solid left-hand hitter. He can run, he can throw, fine range at short, and he still has that aggressiveness, that intelligence, and he just has a flair for the game that's it's fun to watch. I think he reminds one of a young Paul Molitor, a young Robin Yount, some of the key guys, the key veterans in our club. Billy reminds me of the way they were when they were younger players.
With clutch hitting and fielding, Spiers showed poise and maturity, dazzling the fans and opponents with spectacular plays. Another young player with promise is outfielder Greg Vaughn. Called up in mid-August after leading the minor leagues with 26 homers and driving in 92 runs at Denver, Vaughn provided an immediate offensive spark. He drove in 23 runs, hit 5 homers, and that happened in only 38 games. Vaughn put on quite a show for his hometown fans in a pair of September games against the Oakland A's. The California native went 5-for-8 with 3 home runs and 8 runs batted in, including round trippers against Dave Stewart and Dennis Eckersley. What does the future hold? The Brewers are anxious to get started on the 90s.
It gives us good feeling for the 1990s. We had a pretty good decade in the 80s. Not as good as some, but one of the better records among the 26 clubs. And we have the feeling right now in the threshold of the 90s to believe that we can be a legitimate contending ball club through most of that decade.
I think this organization has great things in store for it. There's no question in my mind that that the 1990s will be a very exciting decade, not only for the Brewers, but for baseball. Unquestionably, baseball is at the height of its popularity and its history. And I think the Brewers are poised to really make a really great mark in baseball in the 1990s. I think it's going to be a very exciting decade.
We're contenders. We agreed with the experts in 89 who said we would win. I'm afraid we didn't play well enough to win, but we're looking towards 1990 to make those experts correct because we've got some work to do. We know we've got to clear some things up. We know we've got to work harder, and we know we've got to go to spring training and start our season next year with the thought that everything we went through in 1989 was to make us a better team, a more competent team, a more aggressive team, a more intelligent team, and a team ready to be that true contender in 1990.
You know, baseball cards are real popular these days. For one Ron Say, I can get a whole case of my favorite beer, Miller Lite. I don't want some watered-down minor league version of a regular beer. I want the less filling beer that tastes great.
Hey, Ace! Give me two cases, you can have this baby.
Dream on.
One case.
Nope.
A six-pack.
Mm-mm.
A half a can?
The Big League Light Beer, Miller Lite, where less filling tastes great.
Okay, I'll give you two cases, and you don't have to take the cart. But that's my final offer.
Must have a couple of mine already.
Whoa.
Turning 20, the story of the 1989 Milwaukee Brewers was presented by America's favorite light beer, Miller Lite. When it's Miller Lite, less filling tastes great.